I used to say to myself that I would like to believe that in the end that the forces that connect us together will overpower the forces that want to surveil and oppress. But that belief has taken a beating in recent months.
We do have to understand that that data is being collected, and it's being collected on a greater scale over longer periods of time.
We tend to think that just because someone has our birth date, our gender, and our zip code, it may not seem like a big deal. Those three pieces of information can be used to identify over 80% of the U.S. population.
You know, people will buy a gadget knowing it's insecure if it's going to be fun to play with.
You know, one of the big issues with the Internet of Things is how compromisable they all are. I don't know if you saw the story recently about information from like the Amazon Alexa getting used in a crime.
One piece of smart technology could help solve a murder mystery in Arkansas.
The fact that that Echo device is constantly listening, that you might issue a command at any time, of course it's listening to everything else too, and the potential for that is pretty stunning.
And now investigators want Amazon to hand over data from Bates' virtual assistant known as the Amazon Echo. In their warrant, they say data from the device could help them prosecute Bates.
Now, I mean, certainly, I personally don't have a problem with somebody subpoenaing, police using a warrant to get information from Amazon if they think a crime's been committed, as long as it's a narrowly tailored warrant. But I don't think that I'm totally comfortable with having something that listens to me all day in my home and that it's getting stored on a server.
The fact we can read almost every week about a major company being attacked, right?
Retail giant Target sending out a big alert today that breach of shoppers' private information, bigger than they knew, nearly three times bigger.
New developments in that massive hack attack. And as we're on the air, we have learned that authorities now suspect Russian hackers were behind the 500 million personal email accounts that have now been hacked.
In some cases, that's just after money. Sometimes it's customer records.
Target admitting the holiday hacking incident it thought impacted 40 million credit and debit cards, actually hitting as many as 70 million more customers who not only shopped in stores, but also online. Their names, mailing addresses, phone numbers, and emails tonight in the hands of criminals.
This is what the bad guys are trying to get after.
Plus, this new twist. It's not just those who shopped at Target over the holidays, but at any point in the past.
And I think a lot of people who hand over information to companies and don't really think about it, don't really worry about it, don't really have a feel or an intuition for just how much personal, how many conclusions can be teased out of big data sets today.
The companies that collect and sell billions of bits of information about all aspects of our online lives. Information that includes purchases, income, political affiliations, even religion.
The big data analytics techniques that allow information from different sources to be combined together and reveal things that, you know, that most people would be surprised to learn companies know about them.
As FTC Chairwoman Edith Ramirez put it, it's time to bring transparency and accountability to bear on this industry on behalf of consumers, many of whom are unaware that data brokers even exist.
It is really hard to be a citizen of the modern world right now and really honestly look at the terms of privacy policies and accept that situation.
Thank you.
One of the problems that you see, particularly with apps and new companies, is that people are sort of developing their business model slowly. So they just collect everything. They collect everything they can because they may need it at some point.
There is kind of a motivation right now to slurp up as much data as you possibly can, whether or not you quite know what to do with it right now or not. So you can get data through direct interactions with someone. They ordered a product from you, they sent you a question, they went to your website, they interacted with you in some way. And some products are able also to do some type of surveillance on the people that are using those products. And that's, I think, where people may be less aware that data is being collected.
Location data is an extremely personal and revealing set of information. It can reveal, you know, your political and medical and sexual and religious activities.
If you're going to a particular place every Sunday at 10 in the morning, then I know where you're going to church, you know, or like that, you know, regular meetings are something that's very easy to track. It actually was a real wake-up call to me. Even with location services off, my phone was tracking like the places that I visited the most often, and my therapist office popped up on here. That was one thing that made my therapist didn't double take. Like, she warned everybody about it because, you know, I didn't care that I was seeing a therapist, but other people are more careful about such things and need to be.
Well, car breaks down the middle of nowhere, and they can tell that this car is in this XYZ location. There are no houses for a 50-mile radius, and it's been sitting there for 20 minutes. Something's wrong.
But on a larger level location, I mean, that's really my personal time and my personal life, where I'm going, where I'm driving, at what time of day or night I'm driving, you know, what addresses am I visiting.
A lot of them are sometimes in apps, in your phone. So one thing that it's not a tracker per se, but it's location tracking, but that all sorts of like flashlight apps track your location.
I think they usually have a malicious intent of saying, let's put out a flashlight app that asks people things that they don't need to know.
I mean, why does the flashlight app doesn't need your location?
Because let's build something simple everyone needs, and let's attach, you know, some things to it that can do something else.
What it's doing is it's gathering data in the aggregate or specifically to sell to marketers.
And then they can either go sell that data or just collect it and see if there's anything useful in there.
A primary way is through our cell phones, which is the way that the cell phone network operates. They have to know, you know, your phone needs to know where you are. That doesn't mean that the cell phone companies need to keep that data, which they do too much, too long.
Okay, I'm going from here to my home state of North Carolina. When I'm back in Vermont, get rid of that data. Let's not need it anymore. You know, no need to hold on to it.
And then there's a whole other level of particular apps that might collect your location data, like Google Maps, etc.
With Google, you can tell every location I've been to. Because on my phone, if I go to Michael's to buy some knitting yarn, I look at my phone, I got a coupon because I'm at Michael's.
You know, there are technologies involving Bluetooth and beacons that will track your location and try and feed ads to you based on that. And of course, all that data is stored up because, you know, companies never know how they might use something in the future when their analytics improves. See increased efforts to monetize people's location data. You know, what should happen is that people's location should not be tracked in any way unless they specifically give permission to a certain company for a very specific benefit. You know, we need some good protections to make sure that that people at least have choice and control over what information they're sharing with companies.
I mean, I always find that alarming, that something that I searched yesterday for, now I'm seeing ads for.
It never fails where I go to Amazon, I search for something, and within a few minutes, I go to Facebook, I refresh my page, and that very item is in my ads all of a sudden.
You see it with Amazon, and I see it at Etsy too. Like, things from your purchase history, we think you might be able to, you might want to buy this other thing. And sometimes I find that really useful, I have to admit, on Amazon. Like, other people have bought this book, I'm like, yeah, I may want that book too. That's a good point.
But when you take the information and put it together over a period of about a month, you start to build a profile of this person, what they're like. Like, you can look at my internet searches and know that I have a two-year-old child, that I probably have kids under who are not teenagers.
And I don't know which companies do this, because lots of times companies want to leave the data to themselves. But they can sell that information if they want to. They usually say in their privacy policy that they won't sell any personally identifiable information. But one of the issues is that technologies keep changing. So what was not personally identifiable last year may identify you this year.
The intent of the application is to know who you are and to be able to service that, and that puts the onus more on the company that's handling that data to make sure that they're protecting it.
One of the privacy experts here who's moved on to a couple other jobs, he was really careful about everything, but I just remember him looking at me and sighing and saying, I'm Amazon's bitch. Yeah. Because he bought everything through Amazon. They knew everything about him. You know, and that is just, it's sobering. It's sobering.
So there's a big incentive for companies to be able to, instead of relying on the old ways of advertising, of, you know, broadcast TV, print in the newspaper, that you were, you know, really extending a message to a large portion of the community and society that may or may not be interested in the product. For advertisers, it's much more appealing to say, oh, this is a person whose lifestyle, demographics, interest would align with our product. They're much more willing to kind of pay for that type of advertising, and it's simple. I mean, in terms of the way that you can deliver that content is all done through algorithms and web technologies.
It's a real problem. I mean, we're living in kind of a wild west where all kinds of different companies are moving to exploit data in new ways. And the technology is evolving so quickly that it's allowing, you know, the collection of unprecedented amounts and detail of personal information that is then sliced and diced and analyzed in unprecedented new ways. And, you know, sometimes this can help consumers, but a lot of it is more to help the companies. You know, there are real concerns that this will just shift power from individuals to companies.
We've done mass data analysis before, saying, like, when Church Street, when they put in wireless down Church Street, and then a year later they report we're tracking shopping. That's really just tracking where people stop and how long they spend in stores. So other stores can figure, well, if I'm next to them, maybe they'll come into my store. That have put in Bluetooth devices that if you join the store as like use their app on your phone, it can track you around the store and keep track of where you were, how long you were there, and what you bought.
You know, face recognition is a very powerful technology that has a lot of potential to invade privacy, because, you know, we've seen cameras proliferate around our streets and neighborhoods and cities and stores in recent years. And if you can be identified and tagged, then that opens up a bunch of new possibilities, including the possibility of blacklisting customers, of rating customers when they walk in the store. You know, this person's rich, this person's not rich, this person has good credit, this person doesn't have credit. Because once you know who somebody is, you can tap into all kinds of other databases about that person.
If you belong to the Target Club and you don't, and you're both shopping in Target, it's going to give you a better deal. Like individual sales, it's going to actually compute an algorithm to give you a different price than you while you're shopping in the store. If you brought the same item, walked up to the counter, it would be something like, let's say you're in there and you're going to buy diapers. Okay, that was the example they used. Okay, and you usually buy this one brand of diaper, while the other brand says, okay, give them a 10% discount on ours. If they're there, and as you're standing there, you get a message on your phone saying 10% on these diapers right now for you. That was individual for you. And so this time, real-time dynamic shopping and costing is what's going to come out of this.
Now, using credit cards exposes a huge amount of detail about your life to you, where you're traveling, what you're buying, potentially who you're with.
And this is something that people laugh at me about, but I use cash a little more often than I used to. Not because I'm embarrassed about anything I'm buying, but it does make me uncomfortable to see that they're, because if you use your ATM card or your credit card for every purchase, they don't just know what you buy, they know where you are. So I just started to just use cash a little more often, just to try to like throw a wrench in the works.
Yeah. What's a good phone number for you?
978-555-3542.
Have you ever talked to you before?
No.
What's your first name?
Heather.
No, you're
right. And last name?
Stevens.
And a zip code?
05432. Yeah.
And do you want to be part of our email list for coupons and promotions?
Even any of the stores, when they want your email address, but that can often be tied back to your regular address, they could tie it to what neighborhood you live in, and if it's a wealthy neighborhood, then you're a different type class of shopper than a not-so-wealthy neighborhood.
I'm all set. Thank you, though.
I don't even think they know what they're going to do with all this data yet. But it's becoming so they will have it all available to, you know, manipulate and calculate on.
There was a case where a major credit card company, I think it was American Express, lowered a man's credit rating, and he called it up and said, "Why'd you lower my credit rating?" And they said, "Because our analytics show that other people who shop at some of these stores you've been shopping at have had bad credit." So through a sort of mathematical process of guilt by association, they lowered his credit rating. From the perspective of American Express, that made total sense. They were limiting their risk and et cetera. From the perspective of that man, it was totally unfair. It was guilt by association. And I think that's the fundamental problem with today's big data techniques, which is they allow for efficiencies that increase profits and lower risk by companies, but in the process, they can be completely unfair to individuals. Which is why we can't let, you know, there be a completely unregulated Wild West here with no privacy protections.
What honestly disturbs me more than use of this in advertising is uses of this to make substantial decisions about people's lives.
People should have control over what information about themselves goes out into the world. I mean, obviously, there's sometimes you can't have control. When you're walking down the sidewalk, people can see you, you can see them. We just have decided that everybody's going to have a license plate number on their vehicle, and that when you buy or sell a house, it's going to be a public fact. But there are many other areas where you should have control over what other people can learn about you. And unfortunately, we don't.
You don't have to have a particular piece of data from a hospital, for example, that says you have a disease. You can simply say, oh, well, you liked this page on Facebook. Now, does that mean that you have that disease? No, it doesn't. Maybe you have a friend or family member, or maybe you do research on that subject, or who knows why. So in many ways, these kind of proxy data can lead to kind of unfair conclusions about people.
Say that when it comes to algorithms that make decisions about people's lives, the first principle, the most important thing, is transparency, transparency, transparency. If you don't know what's going on, if you don't know what the logic is, you can't even begin to have the discussion about whether it makes sense to give any particular algorithm a role in decisions that can affect people's lives.
Big, important decisions about people's lives are more and more made based on what feel to me somewhat arbitrary and unfair pieces of data that those people could not have predicted the impact of their actions.
Privacy is not as much in our hands as it should be. There's some things you can do, but it's more in the hands of companies right now than it is in individuals' hands, and that's not the way it should be.
A few years ago, there was a video out. You probably can find it on YouTube. It's called If the Airline Industry Ran Like Healthcare Does, and it's actually pretty painful to watch. So really trying to streamline that experience is, I think, where there's been a shift in healthcare IT and the shift towards taking advantage of consumer devices like the Fitbits and the wearables. And the fact that we all check that device probably over 150 times a day, you know, it's a good place for healthcare interventions too, in terms of reminders, alerts, and those types of things.
Like say you take, for example, a Fitbit or some of these wearable computing devices. You think what all kind of information can they collect? They can, like a Fitbit can collect your heart rate, I believe. You know, it can see if you're going upstairs, you're gaining an elevation. It keeps track of your sleep patterns at night, your pattern of activity throughout the day. There's a lot of information that can be implied there.
Health information, fitness information is among the most personal, intimate information about you, information about your body. And a lot of those protections are not nearly as strong as they should be. And, you know, companies that sell fitness devices and other bodily measurement devices, a lot of them are trying to figure out how to monetize that data. And a lot of consumers, unfortunately, you know, aren't realizing the consequences of that. They don't either they're not aware of how much data collection is going on, or they don't realize that all the ways in which that kind of data can be used and how that can come back to haunt them.
There's a big debate as to whether data coming off of wearables should be part of the patient's official electronic medical record, or should it be like in this bin that people can look at it and look for trends, but you want to validate with what I would call industrial grade diagnostic equipment.
Interestingly, devices like that rarely give you a way to simply view the information, keep it to yourself. You normally have to submit it to an online platform before you can even view it, which is very much part of the point. You know, that companies like that value the data they get from you, not just the money you pay to get the device in the first place.
I think the privacy concern has to be with the individual that chooses to either wear or not wear that device.
Well, I think that many companies try to make it pretty seamless for you to give up your information. They try to make it alluring and for you not to think about it. You know, lots of times companies will, you know, technically disclose what they're doing, you know, in their privacy policy, which is impossible to read. Or even if it is possible to read, even if you do think about it, they try to downplay it.
But the fact that our medical records and everything about this is also out there, what does that mean? And who's looking out for us? And how do I look out for myself?
A medical record probably has more value than a credit card in the dark web. So they sell for anywhere from $50 to $150 for a medical record, where credit cards sell for about $1 to $2. Only because a credit card, once it's been compromised, you know, it can be, obviously they issue a new number and then that number is no good, where medical record data persists. There was a case in California of a young woman that went to give her blood at a blood center, and they refused to allow her to give blood. They wouldn't tell her. She dug and dug, and it took several months, but they finally said, well, because you're HIV positive. And she says, no, I'm not HIV positive. Someone had assumed her identity because they had HIV. They didn't want people to know HIV, but they sought treatment as an HIV patient under her identity. So medical identity theft is a real issue too. Most states, and Massachusetts has it, they have the Mass Highway, where with the patient's consent, I can send that data to, let's say, from a Boston hospital to a hospital in Western Massachusetts. So the answer is there is a better ability to exchange data.
Not so science fiction-y to think about what could happen with our health and medical records.
Typically, people think of healthcare as diagnosis and treatment, and the fact that really using technology to help people maintain a healthy lifestyle is extremely important, and I don't think our healthcare system really advances until we've achieved that.
It constantly surprises me the degree to which people don't care about many things. I think people are just trying to go to work, feed their families.
Most people are busy living their lives. They don't have time to pay attention to this area. If you're not a specialist like I am, things are moving so quickly. The technology is moving quickly. The math is moving quickly.
And I think maybe they think it probably won't matter to them. They think, oh, I don't really have anything to hide. What does it matter if people know all about me? It doesn't matter.
That if you don't spend a lot of time following it, then you're likely not to really keep up and to know just how advanced and how far companies are pushing the use of personal data and invading privacy in the process.
The past several years, I scrolled through those licenses to see what's in there, just to see if I'm going to be installing, agreeing to install software.
Well, I think, first of all, we don't usually read those things that we sign off on that we accept. I mean, how many of us really read those things anymore? We just assume that that somebody is out there looking out for our privacy.
That's why spyware programmers and vendors are multi-million dollar companies, because they write this stuff legally and they put it legally in software, and then you give them permission.
In many of the agreements that you sign in to use these devices, or the terms of agreement to use an application, has in there that data can be sold to third parties.
Software vendors show a much clearer message that's very obvious. Third-party install software that tracks your activity. Do you want to continue or not continue? One of those two.
Like, you'll get something in the mail from the credit card company saying, we're gonna share your information with these new companies unless you check this box and send it back in. You know, and I always check the box and send it back in, but if you don't keep up on your mail, you know, or if you're used to like recycling it all, it's asking a lot from us.
Is that this is all stuff that has to be legislated for the next 10 years, and so the more informed no one's figured out what to do with this yet, the more informed that people are, the better chance that we have of it being the result being what people really want.
First of all, we need to put in place good overarching privacy protections that take the Fair Information Privacy Practice principles and put them into law, as most advanced industrial countries around the world have done. We don't have anything like an overarching privacy law like Europe and Canada have.
So I do believe that legal statutes are necessary, and we don't have to start from scratch. We can follow what the EU is doing.
The EU data protection laws are much better than ours, and I think that in lots of ways we should look to some of what Europe does to protect data. You know, one of the reasons why Europe protects data like that is they know what happens when you start tracking specific minority populations. You know, Germany has really strict laws about what kind of information you can keep on people.
Yeah, I mean, you need overarching privacy legislation that's in place in good general principles, but you often need also specific legislation with regard to particular technologies.
A lot of the privacy rules that govern our email is from the Electronic Communications Privacy Act that was passed in the 80s.
The challenge there is that you don't want to be too technology specific because the technology is moving so quickly. You want to have a rule that will be there in place, you know, as the technology changes.
It's really important that we get more tech savvy people in Congress, because you get some really, really silly things coming out of Congress when people don't know how technology works, and it means they get really swayed by lobbyists who do know how technology works. So
I would love to see more requirements on there being a procedure by which you can request information, a requirement that information be produced, and the ability to fix it. And even more than that, I would like to see organizations that keep private information be required to track who they shared it with.
What I want is to be able to use all the cool things, all, you know, location-based stuff, location-based tools. I want to be able to have some Internet of Things stuff in my house.
I wouldn't have any issues with organizations maintaining data if I knew how they were using it, what they had, and I had the option to opt in or opt out of it.
The core principles of privacy is that you should only collect the minimum amount of information necessary to carry out the purpose that you need it for.
You know, I really want the people that make the next cool thing, the next social media star or the next Netflix or Amazon or whatever, to really bake in some extraordinarily strong privacy protections to help create the future that it is that we want. Because the future isn't just going to happen, right? Technology is going to evolve and change at the lightning pace that we've seen, and we have the opportunity to make that technology what we want it to be.
And if we're saying, okay, maybe I won't express that thought, or I won't upload that idea because it's going to be out there and I don't know who is looking at it, I don't know how it will be used or manipulated. If we're doing that as individuals because we're afraid, then I really think that it undermines what it means to live in a democracy.
Just be suspicious. Be suspicious every time somebody wants your location. Think about how important the technology is to you, the app is to you, before you download it. Just be a little suspicious about it.
At the end of the day, privacy is not something that you can totally protect yourself. You can take a lot of steps to improve things, but at the end of the day, it's a social value that we need to decide as a country that we need to protect. There's only so much the individual can do.